Up until the World Trade Center attacks in 2001, Australia didn't have terror laws. We didn't need them. But in the wake of September 11, Australia passed 61 new pieces of anti-terrorism legislation. 48 new laws in the Howard years, 13 in the Rudd-Gillard years. In fact, between 2001 and 2007, Australia enacted an average of one new anti-terrorism law every 6.7 weeks.
Well, Australia's response to terrorism has been described as being one of hyper-legislation. That is, we've passed an enormous number of laws very quickly. What we've done is often gone too far. We've gone beyond the necessary criminal laws to introducing powers and sanctions that wouldn't even be justified at the time of World War II.
It's meant that under the existing definition of terrorism in Australia, Mandela's fight against apartheid, Syria's anti-government opposition, even the East Timorese battle for independence over Indonesia, were all acts of terrorism. So with such a broad existing base of anti-terrorism laws, why is the government wanting to create more? Anti-terror laws already allow for someone to be detained without charge for 7 days under federal law, 14 days under state law, unique amongst Western democracies. But the government is wanting further powers, and today was quick to deny that under proposed laws, ASIO would be allowed to torture.
It's been said by some that would allow ASIO officers to be engaged in the practice of torture. Now, that assertion, that claim, is not right.
Attorney General George Brandis will introduce the Foreign Fighters Bill this Wednesday, declaring entire countries no-go zones and proposing 5-year jail terms for inciting a terrorist act. But the Criminal Code Act already outlines a 7-year maximum for the same kind of offence.
Australia's already got a very long list of anti-terrorism laws, but what we're seeing is an overreach. Measures that deal in some cases with matters not to do with foreign fighters, or measures that wouldn't even be justified in other countries where they're facing a higher threat of terrorism.
Proposed amendments would significantly lower the threshold when considering on whether or not to arrest someone for terrorism offences without a warrant. Police would only need to suspect on reasonable grounds rather than believe on reasonable grounds they were about to commit a terrorist offence. The amendments would also make it easier for authorities to apply control orders intended to prevent terrorist acts by restricting the movement or activities of certain people, such as forcing them to wear an electronic tag or making them report regularly to police. New provisions would also allow the government to enforce 3-week suspensions of the passports of Australians who are suspected to be planning to prejudice the security of Australia or a foreign country. Also, new provisions for it to be made illegal for Australians to travel to certain places overseas, except to do humanitarian or government work.
Well, Australia's gone through a number of cycles of making anti-terror laws after September 11, after the London 2005 bombings, and now it seems after the threat of returning foreign fighters. And what those cycles show is that Australia does tend to overreact.
Critics who oppose any increase in anti-terror powers say we've got enough laws in place already that work as they did in about 30 raids last week. But the government says it's precisely because of these threats that new laws are needed to counter homegrown terrorism.
It's really important in an area like this that the government isn't given a blank check, remembering, of course, that sometimes dangers emerge not only from terrorism, but also governments misusing their powers.